Pitch black. A Dusklight Story.
Life is. The life is.
What accessibility, and I think, is really about is it's about inclusivity. It's not saying this is a thing for one specific group of people. It's saying this is available to everybody. That's the point. And so releasing on these multiple platforms is really a part of that.
Always the real truth. The day of reckoning will come, and the only people you'll be mocking are yourselves.
My God. It's you. How on earth did you get here?
Now remember, Dusklight's one hell of a city, lad. So keep your wits about you. Not everyone's as holy as they say they are in that wretched hole.
Please welcome, from Purple Jam Limited, Harry Cooper.
And then from then on, I thought, okay, so how do you direct somebody using just sound through an area?
The inspiration behind the upcoming audio game, Pitch Black.
Psycho-Acoustics is the study of human audition or hearing. And so it comes from psychology and acoustics.
A game designed with the blind in mind, psycho-acoustics, and 3D sound. Fade to black. Pitch black. Welcome to Blind Abilities. I'm Jeff Thompson. In the studio today, we got the creator, the designer of Pitch Black, a new audio game coming out, and it's Harry Cooper. How are you doing?
Yeah, I'm good, thanks. How are you, Jeff?
Good. Thanks for taking the time to come on to Blind Abilities and share your project you're working on.
Oh, absolute pleasure. I love talking about the game. It's all good.
Yeah, audio games. Now, this is something for the blind and visually impaired can really get enthralled into, and you're not visually impaired.
No, very true.
So what was your interest to design a game? I mean, this is not easy takings to work with audio in the way that you're going to be doing it and doing it. Mm. What decided to go into this route, this area?
So it kind of stemmed from around this time last year. I got very interested during my studies with ambisonic audio, which is essentially, instead of having two channels left and right, it's like if you imagine a sphere of sound around the listener's head, that's essentially what ambisonic audio is. And the way you reproduce that physically in a live environment is you have speakers all around the room, whereas studying, they have a big 32 speaker rig, which meant you could play sounds around the room in 3D that you just couldn't do with stereo. But the problem with that is, of course, very few people have the room in their house or the money to have that many speakers around. And also not a lot of audio gets created for that sort of setup. So the way to make that more approachable for everybody is to condense it down into binaural, which essentially is doing the same thing, but it's tricking your brain using something called HRTFs into thinking that sounds are behind, in front, above and below, essentially recreating that 3D effect, but just with the two channels left and right. So once I sort of got involved with that, my background's actually a musical one. I was very interested in how you might create explorable music that made use of this binaural audio. So through doing that, I started looking at game engines and which ones used binaural and the sound systems within that. And I'd done a bit of coding before. And then from then on, I thought, oh, okay, so how do you direct somebody using just sound through an area? At what causes humans to walk in a certain direction? So started looking at various studies. And then from then, I thought, okay, well, how do you make puzzles out of this? How do you make challenges? And once you get to that point, it's kind of becoming a game rather than explorable music. And so I got my friend Connor involved to try and put a narrative together to tie in these little audio puzzles I was making in Unity. And from that on, we got very much into the world building and the narrative expanded. And then we got my friend Jordan Barry involved, who's a great sound designer, good at marketing. And we spent all these sessions sort of growing this world, growing this narrative. And it changed from being this small sort of set of audio puzzles into this big, expansive sound game experience. So it kind of just snowballed really from an interest around this time last year into this great project we've got now.
When you're talking about the experience with sound, like say someone goes from one room to another room, once you get that formula down, you can use that as you pass through other areas?
Yeah, so the funnily enough, the transitions are one of the hardest things to achieve with spatial audio, because if you imagine walking through a doorway, what's happening is, if you've got a wall either side of you, you're going for one reverberant space, and there's a point where you've got a little bit of the previous reverberant space mm-hmm. coming in from behind and a little bit of the new space coming at you. So it's not a simple sort of fade. You have to, in some ways, model the physics and reflections of that. So that is quite a tricky thing to get right. But as you say, once you've sussed it, you can then do it across multiple.
Yeah, it makes perfectly good sense that you're interested in this, because blind and visually impaired people are really focused on the audio cues that they're receiving every day, 24 hours. And with your study, it'd be interesting to see what you do with music someday, like when The Who came out with Quadrophenia, four speakers. Yeah. Everyone thought, wow, four speakers. So I'm wondering, when you're in this pitch black, mm-hmm. when you're in there, it's all on a level. Can you go up or down as well? Like on, I suppose, stairs would bring you up to another level.
Yeah. So what we're doing is, as regards the way the character is facing, as regards rotation, we didn't want to, because we're avoiding having to use a mouse because a lot of blind and visually impaired people aren't used to the mouse. So there then isn't a simple way of making look up and down intuitive, really. So we're not allowing the player to move their head up and down as if you were looking at something that's elevated, but we are going to have things that go overhead and go underneath. So you still get a sense of up-downness or elevation, but without the confusion of potentially spending the whole time facing upwards without realizing, sort of thing.
Oh, this is really cool. I like the science that you got going on, all this, all the ology going on, like you used psycho-acoustics. Can you explain that one?
Yeah. So psychoacoustics is the study of human audition or hearing. And so it comes from psychology and acoustics, which makes sense. And it's really funny, actually, because what humans perceive is very different from just the physical sound waves within a room. There are lots of cognitive biases that go on, which are based from an evolutionary perspective or from a development perspective of what's going to keep us alive. So for example, you have things like, if something is approaching you at speed, you'll perceive the decibel level or volume level of that to be significantly higher than what it actually is physically. You have other examples of, even if you're closer, say you're in a room with two speakers and the same sound is playing from both. If you're closer to the speaker on the right, you're going to perceive it as coming from there, even though it's coming at equal levels from each speaker. There are lots of biasing effects that get put on perception rather than the physics. So that's sort of psychoacoustics. It's that area of study.
That's really interesting. Explain to us the storyline, the creation of Pitch Black.
Yeah, so in the story, you play, call him an infiltrator. He's a member of the rebel group, if you like. And the city of Dusklight itself is, it's not so much a dictatorship, but it's very authoritarian in the same way that 1984 is, for instance. And so what you're doing is trying to investigate the truth behind how the powers that be, in this case, we have a church and also a big sort of corporation that sort of control the city. And there's a great secret that they're hiding from everyone. And you play the character that's trying to find out what that is.
Ah, you have this coming out. Your plan is to have this coming out on PC, Mac, Linux, iOS, Android, the whole shebang.
Yeah. Yeah, suddenly get a huge rise in the Kickstarter, potentially consoles, but that's a future sort of stretch goal, I suppose.
With the arcade of iOS, they say you could use the console controls from what, PlayStation?
Ah, I haven't heard of that, but that would be great.
Yeah, interesting. You guys are right on top of it here. Usually you see something come out and it's on one and everyone's asking for something else, but that's pretty aggressive to actually make it available to all. I mean, you're really being inclusive, not just for the blind and visually impaired, but to all users of games.
Yeah, well, exactly. I mean, it's a really not a funny thing, but it's quite a delicate thing because what you really want to make, or what accessibility, and I think, is really about, is it's about inclusivity. It's not saying this is a thing for one specific group of people. It's saying this is available to everybody. That's the point. And so releasing on these multiple platforms is really a part of that. And from a development perspective, it's also very interesting because you have to figure out different control schemes and make sure the system works on different levels of power, particularly on mobile. You get your very top of the range phones and your very bottom of the range phones. And it's actually quite a nice challenge to try and make sure everything runs and is still perceptually realistic. And so you don't lose too much audio quality despite having to scale things back.
So you said Connor came up with the storyline?
Yeah. Well, so he's written the whole script, including all the caveat conversations and market store sellers that you'll hear in the demo if you play it.
And you guys met in college, right?
Yeah, so we're all studying music production at a master's level at University of Derby in England.
You guys just all came together with this and it's just working out?
Yeah, well, absolutely. I mean, the course is called music production, you actually do a very broad range of things, from creating plugins to sound design to perceptual mechanisms of audition to business management. So it's really a broad range. And so some of those modules really inspired us to, we still all make music ourselves, but just move away from your sort of traditional studio kind of job and start developing this kind of quite unique project.
So for the music and sounds for the game, how are you creating all that?
So all the soundtrack to the game we're doing between us, because we all play instruments and write songs and stuff. And we're recording, we actually have our own little studios separately, and we have access to another very well established studio that's got a gorgeous mix desk in it and everything sounds great in there. So it's a combination of those. And the sound design, we're doing quite a lot of our own Foley, using some 3D microphones as well as spot microphones. And then we're also using sampling sites such as Splice to get sort of various crowd noises. So it's a combination of lots of different assets and ways of getting.
When you're talking about Foley, you're talking about how they used to do radio shows, like with two blocks of wood, make it sound like someone's walking and creating all that sound. So you're actually creating sound yourself.
Yeah, particularly things like footsteps, for instance. You can get footsteps, but often you find if you've got the equipment, it's just easier to record them yourself, because you can spend an hour on YouTube or Splice or whatever looking for footstep, or you can put on some shoes and record yourself walking. It kind of makes a lot of sense to do a lot of your own stuff.
Someone who's used special effects quite a bit, I know what you mean. You're going through, no, those are high heels. Those are boots. Those are work boots. So that's on gravel. And yeah. An hour's gone and you're nowhere.
Yeah, absolutely.
So that's pretty neat that you're going to that level. You're probably learning a lot taking on this initiative, this drive to do this. You're probably learning a lot along the way.
Absolutely. I mean, it's tremendously corny, but one of my favorite things is whatever you do, as long as you're learning, you're progressing, right? So even if a project fails in any way, the amount of challenges you've had to overcome and the amount of progression you've had personally and professionally through doing that, it's still worth a worthwhile thing, you know?
Well, I think you guys are doing a very worthwhile thing, because this is exciting to know that you're taking your education, everything that you... It's like we created a test tube and you're out there now doing it for us, you know? But your people that you're working with and all that. I love the science of sound and everything. And you're taking that instead of just saying it's left, right, you know? I've seen that all the time, but it seems like you're going a little deeper, especially when you're talking about the transitions and the complications of it. You understand it and putting all that into it. It just seems like something I would like to invest in, and you got a Kickstarter going now for this project too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the Kickstarter's going really well. We hit our sort of minimum funding target a couple of days ago, which was fantastic. We've just announced our first stretch goal, which is transferable saves between your sort of desktop version and your mobile version, so you can take your progress sort of on the road.
Ah, people can contribute to it. And there's so many different levels. I was going through the levels. You get all the way down to the bottom one where you're almost on the front cover of this thing.
Yeah, well, in the credits, we're going to have a spoken credits at the end. And everyone who's helped us and pledged and tested and all the voice actors, that they'll all, you know, spoken mention at the end.
Well, that's really great. Well, Harry, I want to thank you so much for coming on The Blind Abilities and talking about Pitch Black, the new audio game that's in the works, and it's due out next year. And I'm excited for you guys, and I'm excited to see it come out.
Thanks very much. Absolute pleasure to come on.
It was great to have Harry Cooper on the show to talk about Pitch Black. Be sure to go check it out. And you can get demos of the game, whether you're on PC, the Mac, download them, check them out. You can listen to trailers that they have made and some demos from our own Jesse Anderson from the great state of Minnesota. He does it on Illegally Sighted. So check it out. Check out the show notes and Purple Jam Limited Pitch Black on Facebook at Purple Jam Limited, on Twitter at Dusklight Pro. Be sure to enable the Blind Abilities skill on your Amazon device just by saying, "Enable Blind Abilities." Ask any of your smart devices to play the Blind Abilities podcast. I want to thank you for listening. Hope you enjoyed. And until next time, bye-bye.
When we share
what we see through
each other's eyes, we can then begin to bridge the gap between the limited expectations and the realities of blind abilities.
For more podcasts with a blindness perspective, check us out on the web at www.blindabilities.com, on Twitter at blindabilities, download our app from the App Store, Blind Abilities, that's two words, or send us an email at info@blindabilities.com. Thanks for listening.